Thank you for coming. Only a few people here, but still. My name is Yuri Nesvet. I'm working in the company DevBridge. We are going to talk about accessibility a bit. An important thing that we are basing in the United States. So this is a very nice thing, considering that here are very few people, and the fact that this year was a very major year in accessibility. Actually, on January 18 this year, that was like a first deadline when all federal institutions in the United States has to be accessible. This happened for the first time in the United States, and in other countries it will be happen later. So actually, I'm surprised that there are so few people here. So probably that means that not so many people works for federal institutions in America. But still, there are the same requirements coming for European Union, and actually not many people works for that as well. So that's interesting. But still, let's talk about the situation. In the beginning, I would like to start with the common language, because it's a funny situation. Some months ago, I was interviewing a guy for a QA job in DevBridge, and we did a small exercise with a web page, and he was asked, what about accessibility here? And his answer was, oh yeah, it should be accessible. For example, if you have login form, there should be HTTPS, not HTTP. Okay. And then we did some market research in Europe, and we asked how about accessibility. Is there any wave of interest in accessibility in Europe? And we got an answer from Headhunter agency. And they said that, yes, there is a lot of accessibility interest in Europe, for example, here, and here. And they sent to us access management position. So there is big misunderstanding still, what is accessibility, and people are mixing up with security. And here we have a tab, and some questions are coming. And actually, the first question is about hacking websites. So no, it's not a security stuff. It's about accessibility. It's another thing. So I was afraid that after this wars, half of the people will just leave the room. But OK, that didn't happen. So yeah, accessibility is a part of usability testing, part of usability, not only testing, when we consider that there are many people. Some of them have all abilities, and some of them have disabilities. And we will talk a bit about requirements here. And the good thing that this has changed, for example, 1 year ago, we have to speak a lot about different laws and different standards. But during this year, a lot of things has happened. For example, in the United States, there were such things as ADA or Section 508. But ADA was canceled, thank God. That wasn't a very nice thing. It was canceled right before the new year. And Section 508, a lot of people were struggling with Section 508 requirements. There was a checklist that is still available in Google. But it's not relevant anymore because Section 508 linked their technical standard to the one and only great source of requirements, which is called WCAG 2.1. Actually, it doesn't matter which market are you working with. It's not only about the United States. Same in Europe and the same all the countries, Africa, Oceania, Australia, and so on. Everyone is going towards WCAG 2.0. Now it's 2.1, but soon it will be 3.0. It's already in development. So that's the only source that is relevant today, so we will speak about that one. And as I said, it's an interesting time, and I'm surprised about still not the first year, but I'm still surprised about amount of people that is coming to accessibility lectures because, well, I can understand that maybe for European Union, but there is no interest for United States. Maybe not so many corporations are here in Vilnius who are working for United States market. But yeah, they had the first deadline, and since January 18 this year, all federal websites in the United States should be accessible. In Europe, there will be three deadlines. First of them is coming next September, then September 1 year later, and until 2021, I think. They have three different deadlines. It's only about federal institutions, so I really don't have statistics how many corporations or different companies are working here in Vilnius for building some federal stuff for European Union, but it seems that not so many, because there is no big wave of interest and the deadline is coming. As I said before, DevBridge is based in Chicago in the United States, so we thought we will catch that wave pretty early, but no. We were working for like 10 years, and the first client which came with accessibility requirement was pretty late. It was in 2018. So it's just 2 years prior the big deadline, we received the first client which said, yes, we should have that. So I'm going to basically tell our story, how it happened in our place, because we did some good things. We did also some mistakes. And as then we traveled, we spoke with many different people about accessibility. We were on some conferences in different parts of the world. And some of our problems are not unique, and it happens all around the world. So maybe it will be useful for someone. So let's start with us. As I said, in 2016, we received one client, which is, I cannot tell the name, but it's a pretty big client, which said, let's start one project. It was just a regular project, and everything was fine. It's standard Scrum, very nice, 20 people, a few teams. It was very nice project, sprint after sprint. Designs are being developed prior other development, then front-enders were doing their job, testers were doing their job, everything was just fine. But the problem was that around sprint 6, or maybe it was in sprint 7, the clients said, they kind of remembered, oh yeah, we need to be accessible, so let's introduce accessibility here. And this message that was there, like mostly was sent to the testers, hey guys, could you please evaluate what kind of system did we build during those 6 sprints in terms of accessibility? And we did, as I think about it now, we did an awesome thing. We completely failed that project. The problem is that everything was given to the testers, and testers said, okay, accessibility, what is that? Well, we'll have some of us had 10 years of experience of testing and development, but we always knew that there is such thing as accessibility, but no one worked with that. It's kind of outsider. And then we received those requirements. Testers start to look what are the requirements. They start to register a lot of bugs. I'm very, it's pity that I don't have the screenshot, but actually the Jira of that sprint, there was like a big task of red bugs, and there's a small scroll. Testers has registered just 100 of different bugs, and developers didn't have time for actual development. They were still fixing those bugs, and it was like for 2 months. After 2 months, the client saw that and said, okay, we don't need accessibility, let's keep that, because we're spending too much time for it. And the project was released 1 year ago, I think, and it wasn't accessible, partly accessible, because the client was just remembered that experience, and they said, maybe we can live without it. After that, we had some other clients coming and saying that we need accessibility in other projects, and it was a bit scary because the first experience wasn't nice, but we started to do something because we need to do it in a good way. We cannot allow to fail some projects. And then we did a very simple thing. We gathered representatives from 3 teams, QA team, front-end, and testing, design testing and front-end. It's kind of 3 teams that are main for accessibility. They are doing the most of the job. We gathered just 4 representatives from those teams, locked them in one room for a few hours, and they talk with each other. The interesting fact that usually in the projects we are working in a small team, which they are sitting together, they talk a lot, they do all together, they're not separated as in some places. But when those people were closed in one room, they started to speak actually very open. They started to ask questions that weren't asked before. Why do you do that? Why do you do that? Why there was such decision, and so on. And after that, those guys, I was one of them. After clarifying a lot of questions regarding accessibility, they just reviewed all requirements, all VKG requirements. It's if you saw the page, it's 1,200 pages of different. There are 70 paragraphs, but each of those paragraphs has a lot of information. Why should we have this requirement? How to do it, and so on. So there's a lot of information, and we look all of that, and we started to speak how we see each requirement from design point of view, from CAIN point of view, and from front end. After all that, we decided to take some steps inside the company, what should be done and what should be avoided, what was done wrong and what can be done in the future. And we came up with a few interesting things. The first idea is very, very simple. It's the problem in our first project was that the requirements were just thrown after the few sprints, and it was given to our testers, which were not educated enough. at one point we just said, hey, let's just take a look at our project and evaluate what is done here. And people started to read the internet. They started to Google, of course, what is that, what to do here, what can be done. The same happened when the bugs were registered. The same happened on developer side. Developers started to Google also what kind of bugs are that. And the same happened with the design. So people were not ready. So first idea is extremely easy. It's not rocket science, but what should have done it that we should have some accessibility education inside the company. You cannot give it to everyone because usually people are busy with their some other projects, with their some activities. But the good idea is you have the few core people in the company. I like the interesting situation has a company called AT&T. That's a pretty big company in the United States. They have, for example, one guy who is like main responsible guy for accessibility. He manages two guys who are doing the main job about accessibility, and they have a like hierarchy of hundreds of people who are not doing anything about accessibility, but they could do it because they kind of have. They connected with it somehow. Some of them has relativities with disabilities and so on. So they're ready to help, but they don't work much around it. So we have some core people in testing and design teams and front-end teams who are more educated than the others, let's say, and if this needed, they can pass their knowledge. Regarding education, I won't say much because it's pretty simple. There are courses, there are conferences, there is a lot of source of information. Just what we're saying is that we should have done that before that project, so don't wait when it will fall from the sky as it happened on our place. Another nice thing is that we decided that we need to understand how people with disabilities actually behave, how they think, how they navigate, how they browse. We did some research, we talked with them, and it also gave some knowledge. It doesn't give you maybe the right knowledge about how to deal with some of the requirements, but it gives you some interesting mindset. You understand some behavioral patterns, you understand how they browse, how they think, how to Google, and some of the things are not the same as with the requirements. There is a very good phrase, which is there are requirements and there are best practices. And some of the cases, you might fail some of the WCAG requirements, but it's the best practice, and you know that some of the blind people which will use that page, they will benefit from that one. Education of your people is pretty easy subject. It's pretty straightforward. But what is much more interesting than other topic is education your client. There is a general misunderstanding in society about people with disabilities because most of the people think that there is some group of people who are somewhere close. They are not here. They do some strange things. They are not a part of the society. Actually, that's a huge mistake, and the problem is that here might be a problem when you educate your client, because there is kind of two point of view on that problem. One is we can like moral point of view, and another is economical. The problem is that you cannot say to a client that your project will need another $10,000 for accessibility because like your grandma will need that page to be accessible. That's not the language that you use with the client, so you cannot say that. However, it is true, but it's just not those words. So when educating your client, it's negotiations are about not about being pity. It's about understanding the market, understanding that situation. For example, a very nice example that happened this year: app called Pinterest. Probably everyone heard about Pinterest. It's an application when there are pictures of different ideas of design, of recipes, and it's also all about visual stuff, but they upgraded the app and now it's completely accessible. So blind people who are using the screen readers now can use this application. So it is clear that blind people, they also watch movies, they hear music, they listen to music, they do shopping, they use all the same stuff as we do, even as it happened with Pinterest. That was a very interesting stuff with Pinterest. And the easiest way is it shows some statistic and numbers. That's pretty easy. There is a lot of interest numbers on the internet. It's just an example that, for example, in America, amount of people who are older than 65 years old is 19% of population. There are very, very interesting numbers, like, for example, that all amount of people of internet users with disability in the United States is equal to the all internet users in Spain. So you can play with that numbers. But speaking with a client, we should show that there is a that people with disabilities is a huge part of the market, and if we exclude that for the project, it will be just like we are just forgetting about billions of people, losing a lot of market. The nice thing when all your teams are educated is that I see someone wants to take a picture of this slide. The interesting thing about being educated is that you're starting to produce your project accessible by default. You just don't think about it, but it is. The problem is that, not the problem, but the situation is that there is a big difference between the requirements. Some of them are A level, some of them are double A level, and some of them are triple A level. And usually you are aiming for double A level, but actually there is a lot of things that you are not forced to think about it when you're developing, for example, your web pages. For example, you don't have to be super front-end developer to have a normal headers hierarchy. It's kind of clear that the second header goes after first one, then third, and so on. Or for example, there is such requirements as consistent navigation. It's more about design, but you don't have to be super designer to understand that the navigation on all your pages should be the same as on the first page, because it should be clear for your users. And also there is such requirement as language defining tags. One A requirement is saying that the language of the page should be defined in the beginning of your page with the lang tag. But double A requirement is saying that if you have a phrase in another language somewhere in the middle of your page, then it should be also marked with another tag, with also language something, I don't remember quite correctly. But by this small thing doesn't require any hours of development, but actually it gives your pages to a status, to a accessibility status in some points. What is also was wrong, what is still happening sometimes in other companies, as I see, that the accessibility is being given to the team for testers to be evaluated. It's like everybody done with their work, and then testers just evaluated. But no, there is the whole chain how projects are being done. And there is a whole chain from the client to project manager, product owner, then designers, front-enders, and all chain should be there. For example, there are requirements which are usually given to testers, but actually they're responsibilities of design. And for example, in our company, we have a pretty long process of approving of the design. And if some page is already built, and then a tester says that, okay, there is a bad color contrast, designers will never change that page to another colors, because they have to do this approval process again from the beginning. So in a good working process, this part should be given just to designers, and then we should just forget about it. There are several requirements that should be done, could be done, and everyone will benefit from that one. On this design side, it's like consistent navigation, color contrast, blinking. The page should not blink too often, because it might be bad for your health. Such things like bypass blocks, media handling, predictable design, all those things actually can be done by designers pretty early in the project, and then that's it. You don't have to spend a lot of time by checking how it is done. The same with developers. There are such things that should be decided on the developer side, and that's it. That's their responsibility, and how they decide that will work. There is a lot of saying about area usage, because should we use area tags or not? Well, usually the answer is, if you cannot live without them, don't use it. There is automation part, which also can be done as a part of CI process before actually testers. Because before the app is given to testers. And it's pretty efficient when the testers are being limited only to the testing when application is being used exactly as it will be used by user with disabilities. For example, a lot of manual testers with screen reader. Actually, it covers a lot of what was done on previous steps, but it gives you the exact feeling what actually, how the page will be used. The problem with I talk about in developing here, I talked about some automation, and the problem here is that usually when testers are coming to accessibility testing, we all come in from the idea that everything can be automated. It's like we automate our functional tests, and this also being brought to accessibility testing. The problem is that in accessibility testing, the automation is not the same as it is in functional testing. In accessibility, it's just static code check, which is actually not very efficient. Last year, there was a big research on different accessibility automation tools, and the best, I don't have any much details about it, but the problem was that most of the tools collected only 20 to 30% of the bugs. I think the best one has found 37% of the bugs. But it's not very efficient. It should be somewhere in the process, like part of CI when developers are developing their pages, but that's it. It should be not the main instrument for testers. The real threat are false positive, and this is something that blind people are suffering. False positive, it's, for example, when you have alternative text on the... We can take as an example as a picture. There is a picture, and it should have alternative text, which is saying what is there. So the point is that automated test will tell you what is actual, if there is any text, but it won't say anything how good this text is. So actually, this is a real problem. And this year, we were in Austin, Texas, in one big accessibility conference, and there were some people with disabilities who were contributing to general knowledge here, and they were sharing their experience. They said that false positives is what they're suffering a lot from. So, and yeah, as I said before, most of the testing should repeat the behavior of the final users. Another interesting subject that is that about requirements. The problem with VK requirements is that they're not very friendly. It's they were made as a source so that policymakers could make a link from the law to the requirements. Because if you have a law in the country, it cannot use directly the VK requirements. There is a set of laws which have technical standards, and that technical standard is linked with the VKG. So that's what VKG was built, and it's actually too complex for everyday use. Now, we already saw that in the project when it's, usually it happens like that, a new guy comes to the team and we said, we do accessibility here, and if you want to know about accessibility, just go Google, and there is in a Google, you can find VKG, and it's huge. It's 1,200 pages, it requires interpretation, some of them is not clear. The message is that something should be understandable, something should be robust, but not always there are very direct and strict requirements what should be done. So it has to be interpreted. And for developers, it's not the best way to work. So they want to have it very simple. And here I would like to give our kudos to a company called Visa. Sorry, this screenshot has a quite bad quality. But the Visa company, they did a very nice thing, and they wanted to make it online in September, but by some reason they didn't. Maybe they will do it in the future. This year they had a big presentation, and they said a very basic thing. So let's forget about VKG requirements as they are somewhere in the internet. Let's create our own requirements, which are actually extraction of VKG, but let's make it more readable and more user-friendly. So Visa created their own internal requirements in their intranet. It has different naming than VKG requirements, but actually it covers all the same stuff. And what was the best thing for the developers here is that since they know which technologies they use, they don't have many different projects. They have code examples here, so that if new developers comes to the company and he said, now we're working on accessibility here and here, he goes not to some huge requirements in the internet, he goes right to the internal database, and whereas everything is concentrated and very clear with exact code examples. What was interesting, its idea is very simple. It's not something very, very huge, very unique. But when Visa presented this their own internal database, people like were cheering, applauding, and standing, because probably for developers it was very, very it wasn't very friendly to search our answers to in the Google or in the WCAG database. So those are main fine steps. First of all, it's education your client and your people, and it's different approaches. Education of your people is pretty easy. It's requirements. It can be done through courses, conferences, and so on. Educating your client, it's a bit another kind of work, which is usually done by project management. But in some companies, depending on your responsibilities, it can be done probably by any team member. And it's more about understanding of the market and showing economical possibilities, and that people with disabilities are actually a huge part of the world. By having enough educated people, you start producing accessible projects by default, because some of the requirements do not require a lot of additional development. They're just you just write some tags in a different way, and that's it. Your projects are covering 1A or even AA requirements. And in some of the cases, if client doesn't, in our case, we're a project company. If the client doesn't agree to spend another some amount of money on additional work on accessibility, you just know that your team will produce some of the projects by default. That's a very nice thing. The work should be distributed wisely between the team. There are certain things that should be done by developers, certain things that should be done by design team, and so on. And they should be mixed. And don't do the very popular mistake. Don't give everything to the testers so that they could evaluate same thing. No, it's a work that requires different departments. There is a whole chain of departments that should be done. Don't rely on automation and accessibility. Automation is a static code checking, but that's it. It won't say anything about your page. It just say a bit about your code, but it should be. It's not. It doesn't. It's a bad idea to have it as the only and the main type of testing. And the Visa gave us a very nice example that if you, in case it will work probably best in the case if you work on a product company, when you have one product, when you have some technologies, when you have some stability, and it will probably work less and you have project company when you have a lot of different technologies which are changing sometimes. But Visa showed a very nice example that you don't have to spend a lot of time in reading WCAG and constantly Googling it. That happens all the time. But instead of that, you can create some internal guidelines, and that will be very quick and easy to use. That's it. We have 30 minutes. And we have some time for questions.
How does this affect people who are working in back-end development? What should be taken into consideration?
No. It's mostly about front-end. Yeah. Back-end, yeah, no. It's just in our case, we don't have such strict separation of back-end and front-end developers, so we give that knowledge to everyone. But yeah, if you are a backend developer, then, well, we're all going there. So accessibility is like, it's raising. So maybe you can just educate yourself just because it's coming. But usually for backend developers, there is no much work. That's very interesting and good subject. We haven't done it in a company, but it's a very good idea to give the. It happens very often in the United States market and Canada market. They doing it pretty often. They just hire people with disabilities on temporary contracts, and just giving them projects for testing. It's a very good idea. You should try that if you have a possibility, but we haven't done it yet. Yep. Yeah, the problem is Actually, single page apps are raising a lot of questions. The problem is that requirement do not describe every possible situation. So usually we have, yes, there are different frameworks, there are differences. We do not have answer for every possible situation, but usually those questions are appearing all around the world, and we just Google a lot of things because people all have the same questions. Just a couple of weeks ago, I had the question what to do when you have a single page application and you're going through pages and the title doesn't change, but actually the title of the page is one of the most important things for people who use a screen reader. For example, in that case, you have to manually change the title of the page, and yes, different frameworks bring different difficulties, and usually how the community is behaving, well, as I see the internet, everyone just Googling and asking the question, what should we do here, what should we do there, because there is no one standard what to do. So every situation is unique, and we don't have any recipe. Yeah? Yeah, there are two most popular screen readers. Like one is NVDA and another is JAWS. JAWS is it's pretty expensive, but NVDA is free. It's very popular in the world, and it's pretty. We learned how to do it. It had a lot of shortcuts, a lot of possibilities that you can do with some shortcuts from the keyboard. But we learned that, we use it for testing. Most common bug? The most annoying thing is that I cannot say the exact reason for that, but when front-end developers are doing something wrong with the tags and screen reader reads the same parameters a few times. The most popular situation is button, clickable. This is what you hear very often. We also had a lot of problems with color contrast. We had thousands of bugs, but then we understand that if design is done correctly, so then we just forget about it. But it's not something that testers should report a lot. And most common, there were also, I think the most of the bugs in our .dot project came from, we didn't use that there are fixed combinations of screen reader and browsers. There is a survey in internet which is changed. The result of that survey are changing each year. But for example, in the year 2017, there were fixed combination. If you are using NVDA, you should test on Firefox browser. If you use JAWS reader, you should use Internet Explorer. And that's it. You should not test other combination because it won't work. And this, I think, they haven't seen the result of that survey for year 2018 this year, but it might change a bit. But if you start to test around all possible combinations, you will receive a lot of bugs, and they will not solvable. It's just impossible to have it accessible through all readers on all browsers. Okay, then thank you. And we have some time for coffee and snacks, probably.